Hello students, the topic for today's lecture is the Clapeyron-Clausius equation. Clapeyron-Clausius equation, also called as latent heat equation. The Clausius equation is given as the change of pressure with respect to temperature equals the latent heat divided by temperature into V2 minus V1, that is the change in volume. So this relation, that is the Clapeyron-Clausius equation, shows us how the melting points or the boiling point of a substance varies. So whenever there is a change in phase, that is from a solid to a liquid, or liquid to gas, the temperature of the melting or the boiling point depends on the pressure and the characteristic of the substance. In nature, it's a fact that all known substances in the two-phase regions fulfill the Clausius-Clapeyron equation, and this provides the general validity of the first and second law of thermodynamics. Now, to derive this relationship, we will be making use of the Carnot cycle. Now, in this case also, let us consider an engine, a Carnot engine. So, let's say we have a piston, we have a container which has a piston on it, and let's say we have a unit mass of a liquid in the piston. So, this is my working substance. So, we have a liquid of unit mass, that is M is equal to 1 unit of the liquid, and this is a some volume, let's say VA, and it has some pressure on it. Okay, let's say I put some weights on this. Now what I do is, so let's say this is my initial state of the working substance. So it has some pressure, it has some volume VA, and it is at some temperature T. So let us consider the pressure on this piston to be the saturation pressure. And saturation pressure is a pressure at which the liquid changes its phase, that is from liquid state to the vapor state. Now I want to vaporize this liquid by keeping the pressure constant and also the temperature constant. So to vaporize this liquid, what I do is I let the liquid expand. That is, I apply some heat. I keep this on a reservoir. And I input some heat. And as I input some heat, the gas expands at some new position. And in midway, some of it is still liquid and some of the liquid has converted into vapor. So I keep on doing this, and ultimately what I have is, in my piston, all of the liquid is converted into gas, and the temperature remains constant since I had kept it on a reservoir. So let's say I've applied a heat, final total heat of Q1, and the pressure remains same, whatever it was there as before. And the new volume, my new volume is VB. So what I've done is, I vaporized all of the liquid and made it into gas by keeping the pressure constant, that is keeping the pressure at saturation pressure, and the temperature also is kept constant. Now if I have to plot this in the PV diagram, it will look something like this. So this is my PV diagram. So my gas, which was initially at some had some pressure P, and had some volume VA, so let's say this is my volume VA. From here to here, what has happened is the volume has increased. So my new volume is, let's say, VB. But the pressure has remained constant. So I've gone along a straight line from VA to VB, keeping the pressure constant. And in this process, I've also kept T to be constant. So the temperature of this is T. So this is nothing but a type of an isothermal. So I've gone from this state of the gas, this state of the substance, which was liquid, to this state of the substance, which is gas. and my temperature has remained constant. Next, what I do is I isolate this piston such that no heat goes in and no heat comes out. I isolate this system and I let it expand adiabatically. So as I let it expand adiabatically, what I'm basically doing is I'm removing out the weights. So I'm removing out the weights. If I remove out the weights, what happens is, and there is no heat change in this, what happens is there's an adiabatic expansion. And I exaggerate the adiabatic expansion in my PV diagram. So I exaggerate it and this is my expansion. Something like this, very steep curve. So this is my expansion. After the adiabatic expansion, it has reached at this point. It has reached this point. And at this point, now it doesn't have temperature T, but it has temperature has decreased. Now since it is at a low isothermal scale. So the temperature, we could take it to be T minus dT. So let's say the temperature has changed by an amount dT. So the new temperature is T minus dT. And now from here, what I do is, from the adiabatic expansion, I compress the gas isothermally, just as I had done in this process from VA to VB. So now what I do is I keep the piston on a reservoir, and I keep the pressure constant. And I remove out some heat from the cylinder, from this piston. I remove out some heat, let's say Q2 amount of heat is being removed, such that the temperature of the substance remains constant. So what I'm basically doing here is, now this substance was in gaseous state. So I remove, now what we do is, we remove out heat from this substance. Now this substance is in gaseous state. I want to convert this back into the liquid state. So as I remove out heat, the volume starts decreasing, but I keep the pressure constant. I go from this position to this position where all of the gas has been converted to liquid. And from here, I adiabatically compress the gas from here to here. So let's call the first process isothermal expansion as AB, the adiabatic expansion as BC, the isothermal compression as CD, and the adiabatic compression is D. Now again, I've exaggerated this. What it means is the length BC, AD, I've extended to a large extent, but in reality, it's very, very small. So my cycle is somewhat like this, A to B, B to C, C to D, and D to A. So this is my cycle. Now, the efficiency of any engine is given as Q1 by Q2, Q1 minus Q2 divided by Q1. So if you remember, during this process AB, Q1 amount of heat was given into the system, that is into the gas, and Q2 amount of heat was removed out of the gas, and we are going from C to D, such that it becomes liquid. If you remember, I've told you that we are using a Carnot engine. So if we are using a Carnot engine, it means this is a reversible cycle. We can go it along this way. We can also reverse it and go the other way. So this is a reversible cycle. So if it's a reversible cycle, then I can write the efficiency as this is equal to T1 minus T2 divided by T1. So let us call this equation 1. Now in the process AB, going from A to B, Q1 amount of heat was put in the substance to vaporize the liquid. So if you remember, if you see here, Q1 amount of heat was required to vaporize the liquid. That is the change in phase. So if we are changing the phase of any substance, and the heat that is required is nothing but the latent heat, in this case is the latent heat of vaporization times the mass of the substance. Set the mass of the liquid to be 1 unit. So that means Q1 is equal to, since M is equal to 1 unit, that is M is equal to 1, that means Q1 is equal to L. Similarly, in this process CD, some amount of heat was rejected, that is Q2 amount of heat was rejected. So Q2 equals L minus dl. So let's say the heat that is rejected is the initial one which was taken in minus some amount dl. So L minus dl is the amount of heat that is liberated. Now we use Q1 and Q2. So we have a new equation for Q1 and Q2. So we use this both into the equation 1. Using this in equation 1, we get, using both those equation in equation 1, we get L minus dl minus dl divided by L is equal to T minus, now if you remember from PV diagram, T1 was this T, and next temperature was T minus dt. So that means T1 will be T and T2 will be T minus dt. So using that we get T minus dt divided by T. Now cancelling whatever is getting cancelled, we get TL by T equals dt by T. Let us call this equation A. Now we find the amount of work done along the path ABCD. So we find the amount of work done along the path ABCDA. So the work done in going in this along this path is nothing but area under this curve, as we have already started. So the work done to go along ABCDA, work done to go along ABCDA is nothing but area under the curve. But as I had mentioned, you had highly exaggerated the curve. In reality, the curve is something like this, PB. So this is my AB, and the adiabatic curves are very infinitesimally small. And this is my C and D, and this is my VA, this is my VB. So the curve, that is the adiabatic curves, are very, very small. So the adiabatic curves, you take them to be dp, that is a change in pressure. It goes from this pressure to this pressure, this pressure to this pressure. So let's say the change in pressure is dp. So if change in pressure is dp and the work done is area under this curve, then from this diagram what you see is the area of this curve is nothing but dp times the change its length. So it's nothing but length into height. So dp is its height and its length is vb minus va. Now we know for a Carnot engine, we know that for let me draw the schematic of a Carnot engine. We have a hot reservoir, we have a Carnot engine, and we have a cold reservoir. So we take in some Q1 amount of heat from the hot reservoir, we give in some amount of work, or we do some amount of work, and some of the heat is rejected into the cold reservoir Q2. Now the work done is nothing but Q1 minus Q2, and we have already found out what is the value of Q1 and Q2 in terms of latent heat. If you look back, this here what we have found out, Q1 is L, Q2 is L minus dl. So using this in this equation, Q1 is L and Q2 is L minus dl. So using this, cancelling what is getting cancelled, we get work done is equal to dl. So now we have an expression for the work done using this, and we have an expression from the PV diagram which is here. So we can compare. So comparing both these equations, we get dl is equal to dp pb minus va. And using this in equation A, using this in equation A, we get dP by dt. Just substitute this dl in this equation. So we get dP by dt equals L times T VB minus VA. And this is the relation that we wanted. It is the Clausius Clapeyron equation, also called as latent heat equation. Now, what is the significance of this equation? What does it tell you? So it gives us how does the melting point or the boiling point of a substance changes with change in pressure. So let us consider some applications of this. Now, first application is the effect of change of pressure. Effect of change of pressure on the boiling point of any substance, on the boiling point. So whenever we are talking about boiling point, it's basically converting a liquid to a gaseous state. Now, if I convert anything from a liquid to a gaseous state, we all know that the gas will always occupy a larger volume compared to a liquid. So that means if this is my final volume, that is after the liquid has been converted to gas, and this was my initial volume when everything was liquid, then we know that VB will always be greater than VA. And if this is always greater than VA, VB is always greater than VA, that means this term will be positive. And if this term is positive, that means the change in pressure, the rate of change of pressure with respect to temperature will always be positive. So this means, what this means is, with increase in pressure, the boiling point will also increase. Or the vice versa is also true. With the decrease of pressure, the boiling point of the substance will decrease. So that's the reason why liquids boil at a lower temperature under reduced pressure. Now, if we go on higher altitudes, we can boil water at a much lower temperature. What we know is that the water boils at 100 degrees centigrade. But this is true only at the pressure of 1 atmosphere. Now, if we go at a higher altitude, let's say we go on high mountains, and if we try to heat up boil water, we'll see that water boils at a much lower temperature. Maybe 70 degrees centigrade, because the atmospheric pressure at a higher altitude will be much less compared to at sea level. Another application of Clausius Clapeyron is the effect of pressure on the melting point. The second application is effect of change of pressure on the melting point. Now, in the previous case, we had converted liquid to gas. In this case, melting point will be mostly associated with converting a solid to a liquid. In this situation, we come up with two cases. The first case is if the final volume is greater than the initial volume, that is, the volume of the liquid is greater than the volume of the solid, which was its initial phase. So this means the rate of change of pressure with respect to temperature is positive. In such cases where this is positive, the melting point of the substance will increase with the increase in pressure, and vice versa. An example of which follows this effect is wax. Example is wax, where the volume of the melted wax is more than the solid wax. The second case is if the final volume is less than VA. In such case, we see that VB is less than VA. So this term will be negative. So that means dP by dt will give me a negative value. In such cases, the melting point will decrease, melting point of the substance will decrease with increase in pressure. And the vice versa is also true. That is, the melting point of the substance will increase with decrease in pressure. The example of this is ice. So we will see that ice will melt at a temperature lower than 0 degree centigrade, lower than 0 degree centigrade, at higher pressure than the normal pressure. Usually what we see is that the ice melts at 0 degree centigrade, but this is true at a pressure of 1 atmosphere. Now we will be solving some numerical problems. So first problem states that calculate the change in temperature of boiling water when pressure is increased by 27.12 millimeters of mercury. The normal boiling point of water at atmospheric pressure is 100 degrees centigrade. And what are given is the latent heat of vaporization of steam and the specific volume of steam. So whenever you are solving any problem, see that you follow the following methodology. So first, we write whatever is given. So what is given to us is the increase in pressure. So increase in pressure is given as 27.12 millimeters of mercury. In all our problems, we will stick to SI units. So whatever is not in SI units, we will convert it into SI units. So SI units of pressure is Newton per meter square or Pascal. And to convert millimeter of mercury into SI units, we multiply the value 133.32. So we get the value of increase in pressure as 3615. Next, what is given to us is the temperature. So temperature also, as we have done in our previous problem, converted into Kelvin scale. So 100 degree centigrade is 373 Kelvin. And latent heat of vaporization is given to you as 2.26 10 raised to 6 joules per kg. Also given to us is the specific volume of steam. So specific volume is the volume occupied by 1 kg of steam at whatever pressure and temperature conditions. So 1 kg of water vapor is equal to 1674 liters. So this is our final volume, and 1 kg of water is equal to 1 liter. So convert these liters into SI units, that is meter cube. So what we are doing here is we are converting 1 kg of water, which is in its liquid form, into steam, that is water vapor. So what we are told to find is the change in temperature of boiling water. We already know from Clausius-Clapeyron equation that if the pressure is increased, the boiling point of the water also should increase. So we have to find the change in temperature. So from Clausius-Clapeyron equation, we get the rate of change of pressure with respect to temperature is equal to latent heat divided by temperature times change in volume. So in this case, we are converting water, which is in its liquid form, into vapor. So the final volume is occupied by gaseous form and the initial volume is occupied by liquid. So rearrange this equation, we get the change in temperature equation as shown in the screen. So plugging in the values, we get the change in temperature to be 1 Kelvin. So if we increase the pressure on water by 27.12 millimeters of mercury, and the boiling point temperature increases by 1 Kelvin. So in this case, the boiling point of water will be 374 Kelvin. In degree centigrade, it will be 101 degree centigrade. So now let us go to the next problem. The next problem says that 1 kg of water vapor at 100 degree centigrade in what atmospheric pressure occupies a volume of 1640 liters. Find vapor pressure at 99 degree centigrade, and what are given is the latent heat of vaporization of steam. So what is given to us is 1 kg of water vapor equals 1640 liters. So convert it into SI units and we get the final volume occupied by the water. So initially the water is in liquid state. So 1 kg of water occupies 1 liter of volume. So this is our initial volume. This also we have to convert into SI units. So what is mentioned in this problem is the temperature of water vapor is equal to 100 degrees centigrade. Converting it to Kelvin scale, it is 373 Kelvin. And the latent heat of vaporization of steam is given to us. We asked to find the vapor pressure at 99 degrees centigrade. And we are given the water vapor to be at temperature of 100 degrees centigrade. So the decrease in temperature is nothing but the difference in the temperatures of the water vapor from 100 to 99 degrees centigrade. So subtracting, we get the decrease in temperature to be 1 Kelvin. We ask to find how much is the vapor pressure. So again, in this case, we'll be using the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. So this is our Clausius-Clapeyron equation. So rearranging it, we write the equation in terms of dP. And now plugging in the values as given to us, we get change in pressure equals 3697 Newton per meter square. Now what we are asked to find is the vapor pressure, not the change in vapor pressure. So as mentioned in the problem, we get water vapor at 100 degrees centigrade when the pressure is 1 atmosphere. So the initial pressure is nothing but 1 atmosphere, which in terms of SI units is 1.103 into 10 raised to 5. The vapor pressure at 99 degrees centigrade will be the initial pressure minus the change in pressure, that is dP. So the vapor pressure at 99 degrees centigrade equals 1.066 into 10 raised to 5 Pascals or Newton per meter square.